makes me white as snow. On all other fount I know, I am washed, I am washed, I'm drenched in love. Souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb, I'm not ashamed of what once held me down. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, precious is the glow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, 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 oh. All filth may gleam in that crimson sea, I'm not ashamed of what once shackled me. How infinite grace divine, I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, and drenched in love. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood of Jesus. How priceless, how precious, there is power in the blood. I was buried deep with Christ my Lord. Now I am raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fount I know. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love.
Amen. Good morning. Welcome to Mountain Bible Church. I'm just going to ask you guys to turn to someone near you and shake a hand this morning.
My name is Felicia Moore. I am your children's pastor. And I just wanted to take a moment this morning to say thank you to everybody that came Monday night for Harvest Block Party. It was a huge success, and it wouldn't have happened if you guys weren't there. So I just want to say thank you to everybody that helped make the event so special, from everybody who set up to serving. We served over 1,000 hot dogs. We had over 1,000 pounds of candy given out. And a huge thank you to Jeremy Hoff and our youth kids who came and designed the maze this year. Everybody loved the maze again. So we just want to, I just want to say thank you so much from the bottom of my heart to everybody that made that night so special. Let's continue to pray for our families of Payson, and just pray that they all come join us on our campus and desire to have that relationship with Jesus Christ. So we just thank you again for making Monday night happen. And now we're going to let Daniel do the announcements.
Look at that smooth transition. If you don't pay attention, we'll convince you that we're professionals. So, hey, good morning. Welcome to Mountain Bible Church. My name is Daniel Newberry. I'm the youth pastor here. And actually, Felicia just texted me, and she said, after the video, can you also thank cleanup crew and deacons? So, cleanup crew and deacons, thank you guys too from the bottom of Felicia's heart. Listen, I only got a couple announcements for you. First of all, if you're a first time, second time, or even a third time visitor, we would love to get to know you more. If you have questions about the church, or maybe like you've been going here for a long time and you still have questions about the church, you can fill out the back or the fill out those visitor information cards, which are in the backs of the chairs in front of you. And after you fill that out, at the end of the service, just give it to the information desk outside, and someone will give that to a staff member, and a staff member will get a hold of you and answer any questions that you have about the church. Also, for anyone who is in need, Grief Share is going to have a special session called Surviving the Holidays, which is designed to help turn painful reminders of loss into joy during the holiday season. And it's going to be on Wednesday, November 9th from 6 to 8 p.m. in the Lighthouse. So that's Wednesday, November 9th from 6 to 8 in the Lighthouse, and that is their Surviving the Holidays, which I think Grief Share is an absolutely incredible ministry. They have so many people. I mean, I think it was like 20 or 30 different people coming to their Grief Share who are they're getting to help them and minister to them and show them the love of Christ through as they're going through a difficult transition in their life. So the Grief Share ministry is just absolutely incredible. If you don't know more about it, you need to get to know Bill and Tammy because they're awesome. Also, lastly, on Sunday, November 20th, we are going to have our annual Thanksgiving offering. The entire offering that's collected that day is given to support local ministries and outreaches. So hold off on giving until then. I'm just kidding. Don't do that. No, I'm just kidding. But do know that whenever you give money on Sunday, November 20th, all that money is going to go to local ministries for our Thanksgiving offering. That's all the announcements I have for you guys today. Let me pray for us, and let's get back into worshiping the Lord. Let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing all of us together here this morning. Thank you for being a God who is worthy of worship. Thank you for being a God who cares enough about Payson that you have given so many churches to this town to love you and to love the people. And Lord, I ask that as we gather, as the other churches in town gather to worship you, Lord, I ask that you would bring authentic worship of you and that you would bring glory to yourself, not only in our hearts today, but also in the hearts of us throughout the week and in the hearts of those who are not here, that we can bless them in your name. And I pray that as we move into this time of worship, you would bring us into your presence. And then as Pastor Dave comes up here to preach, Lord, I ask that you would speak through him and pierce our hearts with the message of your Son. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen and amen. Hey, let's go ahead and stand up and let's worship the Lord.
Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are. Your promises are yes and amen. Yes, all your promises are yes and amen. Yes, beautiful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are, faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are, and all your promises are yes and amen. Yes, all your promises are yes and amen. I will rest in your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness. As I will rest in your promise, my confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are, yes you are. Faithful forever you will be. Are yes and amen. Yeah, all your promises are yes and amen. Sing faithful, faithful you are. Faithful forever you will be. Amen. Yes, all your promises are yes and amen. Yes, all your promises are yes and amen. Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do. Is all creation groaning? It is. Is a new creation coming? It is. Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing and honor and glory? Because the Father truly loves us, He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And is Jesus our Messiah? Oh, forever those He loves. He does. And our God intend to dwell again with us. He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, from every nation and tongue, He has made us a kingdom, a priest to God, to reign with the Son. Is He worthy? Is He worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy of this? Oh, He is. Blessing and honor and glory, He is worthy of this. He is.
Thank you, Father. God, we ask this morning that as we've proclaimed, God, the truth that we know that You are worthy, that You would move in this place. We sang that the Spirit moves among us. And today we ask that Your Spirit would move in our hearts, God, and draw us closer to You. We love You. In Jesus' name, amen.
You can't sing it enough, can you? He is worthy. He is worthy. Amen. All right. I got bright lights here. We are in Genesis, and we're going to be looking at chapters 43. We'll pick up at verse 16. We stopped at verse 15 last week, and so we'll pick it up there and move on through chapter 44, verse 34, looking at the idea of to recover relationships. Remember, we learned last week that forgiveness is what? It's complicated. Forgiveness is a process. And we're in the middle of that process, or coming to its conclusion here in this story of Joseph. And forgiveness is ultimately aimed at reconciliation. Now, we have kind of looked at this from the viewpoint of Jacob and the brothers. And when we left them last week, we saw the very last words there that in verse 15. They went down to Egypt, and they stood before Joseph, and what we said was, they are now in the vulnerable position. They have taken the risk. They have returned to Egypt. They have brought Benjamin with them, and Jacob is left at home, agonizing over what is going to happen to his son, and ultimately what will happen to all of his sons now. But in the end, I think the conclusion we draw is that Jacob hasn't done a very good job of reconciling with his sons. For years now, there has been that open wound and that unanswered question in regard to what really happened to Joseph. It's been the family secret. It's the thing that no one talks about. It's that which underlies everything that's going on in this family, I believe, for years. and now it is being brought to the surface. And what we're going to find out this morning is that is that where Jacob failed, Joseph is succeeding. And I pray that we will learn some of the principles that will help us to succeed in those areas where perhaps we still need to do some work to bring forgiveness to the point of reconciliation, where we can come together. Because so often in relationships, in families, that final part of the process, the capstone of the forgiveness process is left untouched. And we remain, though we may get together face to face, we remain in our spirits unreconciled, because there is that unanswered issue that has taken place at some point in the past, and now no one really wants to talk about it. And so it, as long as we don't, it's unresolved. As long as we don't develop a strategy to deal with the past, we are left in the past and unable to move into the future. And so that's what we're going to be looking at today. And what we're going to find is that if we want to recover relationships, then the very first thing is we need to extend and receive mercy. All right, so let me start reading in verse 16 and just kind of take this up into verse 23. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to his house steward, I sound loud to myself. Do I sound loud back there to any of you? No? Okay, well, I'll just keep going then. All right. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to his house steward, bring the men into the house. Slay an animal and make ready, for the men are to dine with me at noon. I'll just stop right there. I think that it's interesting that Joseph saw these guys. He saw the brothers before they saw him. Makes me think that perhaps he was watching out for them. He was waiting to see if they would come back. Joseph is patient. He's giving time for this process to work. He had the authority, he had the power that he could have gone into, he could have gone to his family in Israel. He could have gone there, but instead he is waiting for them to make a move to come back. Simeon's still in jail, their brother, and the question of whether they're going to bring Benjamin back, that remains open. All right? Can they be trusted for that? So he sees them in verse 16, and verse 17 then, so the man did as Joseph said and brought the men to the to Joseph's house. Now the men were afraid because they were brought to Joseph's house. And they said, it is because of the money that was returned in our sacks the first time that we are being brought in, that he may seek occasion against us and fall on us and take us for slaves with our donkeys. Notice, they're afraid. The guilty, what did we learn last week? Perfect love casts out fear. When you're afraid, oftentimes the root is guilt. And that guilt is something that these brothers are still dealing with. And so even a kindness, come to my house, have lunch with me, is suspect because of their guilt. Notice the last part of the sentence there in verse 18, that he may seek occasion against us and fall on us and take us for slaves with our donkeys. Take us as slaves. Just as they had done to Joseph, so they are afraid it will be done to them. That's the kind of thing that guilt does. It just keeps us in that place of fear. It keeps us anticipating, almost expecting, that somehow we've got to pay for this and we will be paid in kind. That's why forgiveness is so important. If we don't forgive, we can't release the past. If we are not forgiven, we cannot release the past. We continue to live in that past, in the present and into the future, and it corrupts everything. God has created us for life. And we miss out on so much of that life because we are unforgiven or we will not forgive. Verse 19, so they came near Joseph's house steward and spoke to him at the entrance of the house and said, "Oh, my Lord, we indeed came down the first time to buy food. And it came about when we came to the lodging place that we opened our sacks. And behold, each man's money was in the mouth of his sack, our money in full. So we have brought it back in hand. We have also brought down other money in our hand to buy food. And we do not know who put our money in our sacks." And he said, "Be at ease. Do not be afraid. Your God and the God of your father has given you treasure in your sacks. I had your money." And then he brought Simeon out to them. We're talking about extending mercy and receiving mercy. I just want to offer a caution. And that is, we must understand that mercy can be abused. All right? Joseph has shown mercy to these guys. He has returned their money in their sacks. And the possibility was there that they would deny that they had the money. That they would lie about this just as they have been lying about Joseph being dead. They might have continued in the past, in the past occurrences and the past habit that they have built up of living a lie. Mercy, when we offer it, can be abused. Our Father, God, sent his Son into the world as an act of mercy. Sent his Son, Jesus, into this world so that we might see him, so that there were those who might touch him, who might hear his voice, who might see his acts. We have all of these recorded. That was an act of mercy by our God, our Creator, sending his Son into this world. And that mercy was abused at the cross, wasn't it? And so it is that whenever we offer mercy, we have to ask ourselves the question, am I offering this mercy out of a heart of love? Because if it is from any other place, then it will be suspect. It will be that which just isn't going to work. But God, in his love for us, for fallen humanity, has sent his Son into the world as an act of mercy. That mercy was abused. Know that when you extend mercy and it's abused, you can respond the same way God does. And that is, you can still offer the opportunity for forgiveness and reconciliation, which is what our God does. Understand that when you extend mercy, people you love can be hurt. Verse 24, then the man brought the men into Joseph's house, and he gave them water, and they washed their feet and gave their donkeys fodder. So they prepared the present for Joseph's coming at noon, for they had heard that they were to eat a meal there. And when Joseph came home, they brought into the house to him the present which was in their hand and bowed to the ground before him. And then he asked about their welfare, and he said, "Is your old father well, of whom you spoke? Is he still alive?" And they said, "Your servant, our father, is well. He is still alive." And they bowed down in homage. It's significant that there is no mention after this presentation of the gift. There's no mention of it after that. I mean, what are you going to give a guy who is second to Pharaoh? I mean, he had everything he needed, and it's not what he was looking for from his brothers. He wasn't looking for a gift. But he did know that Jacob, his father, loved him. He probably considered that as his father loved him, that he probably loved Benjamin the same way, in the same manner. That he would be loath to let Benjamin go with the brothers back to Egypt. That he would be fearful Remember last week we said forgiveness. The process of forgiveness is risky. This is the risk that Joseph took when he put together this strategy, and that is that Jacob might die out of just heart sickness over Benjamin, because he wasn't in a place where he could trust the brothers. And that happens so often in our relationships, that we can't trust one another because of the past. And that's why we need to work at rebuilding trust, developing that strategy where we can rebuild trust in our relationships. That's what Joseph is doing here. Not only is Jacob at risk, but the command, listen, if you're going to come back here, you bring your younger brother with you to prove that you are who you are, who you say you are. Benjamin was placed at risk. And these brothers were with Joseph one time, and they wanted to kill him, ended up selling him into slavery. They could have done the same thing with Benjamin. Joseph has actually provided these brothers with an opportunity. That's the risk. They could have done to Benjamin the same thing they did to Joseph. And so, we think about, again, Jesus coming into this world, God sending his son into this world, in order that we might be presented with the opportunity to be forgiven. And we consider that the Son was crucified. The Son was killed on that cross. He was rejected. The mercy that God sent was rejected by the nation of Israel, by the Gentiles who actually crucified him. He was rejected. And I'm going to say that hurt the heart of God. There are times when we plead forgiveness and find it won't be given to us by someone we have hurt. There are times when we offer forgiveness and it's rejected as though nothing ever happened that needed to be forgiven. And we live with a hurt in our heart. Know that if that is the case with you, you can identify with God himself, the one who sent his son into this world, that there is a hurt in his heart every time someone rejects, a hurt in his heart every time someone agrees with those who cried out, crucify him, crucify him. That's the possibility. And that was the possibility with Joseph. All right? How are they going to respond? How are they going to deal with it? I'm glad that my father Jacob is healthy, that he's still alive. I'm glad I see Benjamin there, that he made it down to Egypt without them taking his life or doing him harm in some way. And so what do I do? How do I go on from here? And we know Joseph, he's ready for this. He has the strategy in hand. And what I find here, what do? We test for success. All right? We test for success. Someone reminded me I needed to tell a story today. So from last week. I didn't tell it last week. So I'll tell it today. So there's a guy. I read about this in... I believe it was the LA Times years ago. And so there's a fellow, wealthy individual, who wanted to go on a safari. And so he did so over in Africa someplace. I forget where it was now. And he had a guide. And it was just he and the guide and a couple of other attendants. But he was the guy paying the freight on this. They got to a place where there was a river to cross, and as they were crossing the river, there was a rogue hippopotamus that came after them and attacked them all and took this guy in its mouth and was shaking him around. And the guide and the servants, the attendants, They got away. They went to the other side, made no attempt to help this guy. Just left him essentially for dead. He lost an arm because of this. Ended up on the shore. And basically, as I say, he was left for dead. He managed to crawl away high enough where someone might see him coming down a road. And indeed, someone did. They rescued him. They tended to his wounds. He recovered. Must have been quite a guy, because a few months after, you know, all of this had happened, he wanted to continue his safari. And the guide heard about it, and he came back and said, "Well, here I am. I'll take you on the rest of the safari." Well, you can imagine, that wasn't going to happen. Why? No trust. Now, if it had been a different story, if it had been something where there was a relationship involved, a relationship of love, then you have to have a strategy. In this case, there's no relationship other than a monetary one. And tell you what, if I'm spending my money on you, on a guide, it's not going to be on you. Okay, so that's what we're dealing with when we talk about testing for success. This guy, because there was no relationship, there was no test. But when there is relationship, then there's a test. And the test, remember, is never to see if they will fail. That's not our expectation. The test is intended to bring about good qualities and show off the good qualities that are possible there. We see the potential, and so we offer the test. So what does Joseph do? Verse 29, when Joseph came, when he came home, they brought him into the house, the present, which, I'm sorry, that's verse 26. I want verse 29. As he lifted his eyes, Joseph, as he lifted his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, he said, "Is this your youngest brother, of whom you spoke to me?" And he said, "May God be gracious to you, my son." And Joseph hurried out, for he was deeply stirred over his brother, and he sought a place to weep, and he entered his chamber and wept there. And then he washed his face and came out, and he controlled himself and said, "Serve the meal." So they served him by himself and them by themselves, and the Egyptians who ate with him by themselves, because the Egyptians could not eat bread with the Hebrews, for that is loathsome to the Egyptians. Now they were seated before him, the firstborn according to his birthright, and the youngest according to his youth. And the men looked at one another in astonishment. This guy has some real powers here. That's what they're thinking. And he took portions to them from his own table. But Benjamin's portion was five times as much as theirs. So they feasted and drank freely with him. Five times as much as the other guys. He's going to treat him just the way Jacob had treated Joseph. And let's see how the brothers respond. What are they looking for? What he's searching for is humility. Have these brothers gained any humility in their lives? Joseph was looking for the old resentments and the old jealousies. Are those still there? And so far, it looks like the brothers are passing with flying colors. They don't seem to have the jealousy. Benjamin gets more than them. And that's okay. They're not bothered by that. And then, so we search for humility. Without humility, there's never going to be significant or positive relationship. When we lord it over anyone, when we act like we are without responsibility or we're responsible to no one, that does not make for a great relationship. Great relationship is always founded on humility. Humble enough to lower myself. In the words of the Apostle Paul, thinking of one another as more important than ourselves. And right now, I think in the minds of the brothers, what they're thinking about is their family. We've got to take food back to Egypt. We've got to make sure our father is cared for. We have to make sure that Benjamin comes back alive. Joseph is seeing the right kind of things in the lives of these men. Then we search for unity and sincerity. So we go on in chapter 44. Joseph commanded the house steward and said, "Fill the men's sacks with as much food as they can carry and put each man's money in the mouth of his sack," doing the same thing all over again. "And then put my cup, the silver cup, in the mouth of the sack of the youngest and his money for the grain." And he did as Joseph had told him. And as soon as it was light, the men were sent away with their donkeys. And they had just gone out of the city and were not far off. And Joseph said to the house steward, "Up! Follow the men, and when you overtake them, say to them, 'Why have you repaid evil for good? Is not this the one from which my Lord drinks this cup, that indeed he uses for divination? You have done wrong in this.' And so he overtook them and spoke these words to them. And they said to him, 'Why does my Lord speak such words?'" Basically, they said, "We're innocent of this." He said, "No, well, we're going to search." And so they searched through all the bags, and they found the silver chalice, the cup that Joseph used, in the bag of Benjamin. And so, verse 12, he searched beginning with the oldest and ending with the youngest, and the cup was found in Benjamin's sack. And then they tore their clothes, and then each man loaded his donkey, and they returned to the city. Now understand this. They had the opportunity right now. Joseph has handed it to them. They had the opportunity to go back with all the food, with all the money in their sacks, and say to their father Jacob, "What could we do? Benjamin was taken by this leader in Israel or in Egypt. There's nothing we could have done." They could have legitimately left him behind. But they didn't do that, did they? All of them tore their robes, they loaded their donkeys, and they went back with Benjamin to Egypt. And when Judah and his brothers came to Joseph's house, he was still there, and they fell to the ground before him. There's the humility, there's the unity, there's the sincerity. That's what they're looking for. And in our own relationships, when we're trying to rebuild trust, what do we look for? We look for sincerity. Does this come from a motive of sincerity? Is this just, if I'm seeing confession, if I'm seeing any kind of repentance, is it sincere? That's one of the things that we're looking for, and that's what Joseph is looking for here. The brothers, they respond with united grief and mourning. And so next, in verses 15 through 34, what is required for this recovery of relationship? Confession and repentance. We must confess and we repent. Now, let's talk about confession first. When we talk about confession, it'd be easy. You know, how many times have you heard a child say, we had our grandkids with us the last couple days, 6.5-year-old and a 4-year-old. And one time I heard the mother, Mary, say to the youngest, "Tell your sister you're sorry." "I'm sorry." That's what, she has this great voice for it too. I mean, there is absolutely no sincerity in that at all right? I'm sorry. Confession. It needs to be sincere, right? How do you tell if it's sincere? Well, first of all, confession means you don't make any excuses. You just say, I was wrong. Oftentimes we try to qualify that. I was really feeling sick that day. I wasn't myself. No, confession, that's true, does not make excuses. Excuses don't help anything. I was wrong. There's a psalm, the 38th. And this is what it says. It's verses 14 and 15. It says, yes, I am like a man in whose mouth are no arguments. For I hope in you, O Lord, you will answer, O Lord, my God. I'm like a man in whose mouth are no arguments. When you have hurt someone, you've hurt someone. When you have offended them, you have offended them. And the excuses just don't help. I got a ticket once coming into Payson. I did. And we had come into town. We had been down in the valley, so I was used to driving fast down there, you know. Came back up the hill, coming into town. We're at the intersection of 260 and the B-line. And I was making a left-hand turn onto Longhorn. And I was in the left-hand turn lane. There were three cars in front of me. And all those cars were going the same speed I was. I was the last one in line. And I was the only one who got pulled over. And I wanted desperately to say when the officer came to my window, what about those guys? But when he asked the question, how fast were you going? All I could say was, obviously too fast. I don't know why he picked on me. To this day, I'm a little upset. But what's the point? The point is, listen, if you're confessing, don't make excuses. That is sincere confession. When you're not making excuses, you just say, I did it. And that's it. Notice how these guys respond. Verses 15 and 16. Joseph said to them, what is this deed you have done? Do you not know that such a man as I can indeed practice divination? So Judah, all right, Judah steps up here. So Judah said, what can we say to my Lord? What can we speak? How can we justify ourselves? And what he's saying with those questions is, we can't. We're guilty. The chalice was in his bag. Here we are. He could have gone on. Don't know how it got there. I don't know. How did that happen? No, it's just, what can we say? We cannot justify ourselves. And then he says, God has found out the iniquity of your servants. Acknowledge your wrongdoing. Acknowledge where this comes from. God has found out. Know this. God has found out the iniquity of your servants. I'm thinking of a family right now where there has been a misdeed, a hurt. And things go on like it never happened. I think of pastors who have in one way or another sinned, thinking that that sin will never be seen. God uncovers sin in the lives of his children. He does it every time. You cannot escape that. He will uncover the sin. And if the sin is toward him, all sin is, but I'm saying if it is spiritually in your relationship with him, then he's going to uncover that in your life. If it is with others around you, that is going to be uncovered. They are going to see that. It is going to be made apparent. God has uncovered the iniquity of your servants. That's what he says. Judah. It is so much better. I had a mentor in ministry years ago who, one of his key things that he would say all the time, it ought to be the, for someone who's a Christian, someone who has found life in Christ, confession ought to be the easiest thing in the world to do. Because we are freely forgiven. Jesus said from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. That forgiveness is offered to us freely. Why would we not confess freely to such a God? And if we are certain of the love in a family or in a relationship, if we have seen that trust rebuilt, then confession ought to be the easiest thing in the world to do. Still in verse 16, behold, we are my Lord's slaves, both we and the one in whose possession the cup has been found. What does sincere confession look like? It looks like bowing to the circumstance, bowing to God's involvement, seeing God in whatever is taking place here. Because when you do that, when you bow to the Lord and say, your hand is in this, I'm found guilty, you will be released to live in the freedom that Christ bought for you. And even in that, when you have been exposed in this way, you will be able to celebrate before others how God has forgiven you. And if you've gone through this process with someone else, how you have been forgiven. And that is a testimony that everyone around you wants to hear. Because they want that freedom also. And so, there's got to be sincere confession. There must also be a response with true repentance. And so, verse 17, but he said, Joseph said, far be it from me to do this. The man in whose cup, in whose possession the cup has been found, he shall be my slave. But as for you, go up in peace to your father. And then Judah approached him and said, oh, my Lord, may your servant please speak. I'll speak a word in, may I speak a word in your ears, and do not be angry with your servant, for you are equal to Pharaoh. And then basically what Judah does is he reminds Joseph of how all of this has transpired. You said we were spies. You sent us back. You said we have to bring our son, our youngest brother, Benjamin. We told our father this. Our father said, if you take Benjamin down there, I fear that if he doesn't come back, I will die. So what does it mean to truly repent? It means that you have found a new love. A new love is expressed. Drop down to verse 30. Now therefore, when I come to your servant, my father, this is Judah still speaking, and the lad is not with us, and since his life is bound up in the lad's life, when he sees that the lad is not with us, he will die.
Thus your servants will bring the gray hair of your servant, our father, down to Sheol in sorrow. There is a love for Jacob now that is being expressed by these brothers that they have not expressed previously. They have hidden everything from him. They have been angry at their father because he has treated Joseph so well, more than they, that they had been ignored when Joseph had been showered with love and given a wonderful coat that basically said he was the firstborn when he wasn't. There was all of this animosity, but now we're afraid that our father will die. And we'll be responsible for it if we don't take Benjamin back to our father. There's a new love there. That's part of repentance, is understanding, is bringing to God a statement that says, Lord, I've offended you and I love you. To say to someone, I offended you, but I love you, and so I want to turn around. I want our relationship to be better. I turn around. I turn away from the offensive behavior, and I will live differently. I will bring your son back. That's what Judah's saying. Instead of seeing Joseph as nothing but a slave, seeing Benjamin as nothing but fodder to be thrown into the fire, he says, no, I will stand surety for him. My life for his. I don't want to bring my father's hair down to Sheol in sorrow. And so there's a fundamental change reflected when one truly repents. Verse 32, for your servant became surety for the lad to my father, saying, if I do not bring him back to you, then let me bear the blame before my father forever. Now, therefore, please let your servant remain instead, and the lad a slave to my Lord, and let the lad go instead of the lad, a slave to my Lord, and let the lad go up with his brothers. For how shall I go to my father if the lad is not with me, for fear that I see the evil that would overtake my father? And so the brother who sold Joseph into slavery, it was Judah's idea, now is willing to become a slave for a brother, to save a brother from slavery. To me, that's true repentance. And that's the kind of repentance that our God is looking for. Now this morning, we're going to be celebrating communion. And I've chosen the passage that we're going to look at based on this passage. Can I ask the worship team to come up at this time? But it's the well-known passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And as I read it, I'm going to ask that you consider your life, your relationship with God, but also your relationship with others. Are there any open wounds? Are there any offenses that have not been dealt with? Those are the questions. I'll begin in verse 23, chapter 11, 1 Corinthians. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and you drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body in the blood of the Lord. But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. What that is a statement saying exactly what we have learned, and that is, God brings sin out into the open. It is going to affect us in one way or another. It may be mentally, it may be physically, it may be emotionally, it may be relationally. But that sin is going to tell. God exposes it. He doesn't do this because he wants you to experience more pain. He does it so that you might experience forgiveness and be relieved of the anxiety, relieved of the pain, relieved of the unhealth. For we are his children. When we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world. Our God is not a God who seeks condemnation. He is a God who seeks freedom for us, who seeks life for us. He is a God who leads us in the way of forgiveness. And so, our practice is to come to the table and receive the elements and take them back to your seat until, hold them until we can all partake together. Remember, there are two cups there. Together, one has the juice, one has the bread. If anyone cannot make it to the table, just raise your hand. We have someone who will bring you the elements. But as we're coming, as we're standing waiting, as we are in our chair singing and worshiping, let's bow before our Lord. Let's confess with that sincere confession that says, O Lord God, I love you, number one. Let us bring with that confession anything that he might bring to mind that needs to be expressed. I have done this. I have offended this person. And with it, offer a prayer. Thank you, God, for forgiving me through your Son, Jesus Christ. And give me the wisdom and the enablement to restore relationship where it has been broken. Let this be for us all a holy time and a reconciling time. We will worship our God.
Hour I first believed.
Before our Lord. Our Father, indeed you are the expression of mercy itself, sending your Son to the cross. It's his body that received the lashes of the whip. It was his body that received the spear in the side. It was his head that received the crown of thorns. He is the one who died there, the innocent one. For sinners. As we take this bread in hand and prepare to place it in mouth so that it can be assimilated into our body, we pray that you will bless it and our taking of it, that it would be a sincere offering of praise and glory to you as we remember the death of your Son and its meaning and value to us. The Son of God, hanging on a cross, humiliated, taking our place, being humble. The Son of God suffering death that we deserve. So doing it all so that we can have life. We thank you for what this bread symbolizes, the death of our Lord for us. We take and we eat it in remembrance of him. In the same way, we take the cup and we hold it before our Lord, and we remember the words of Jesus himself that said, "This is the new covenant." That is the promise of God. Then as long as you believe in me, your sins are forgiven. Now and forevermore, they're hidden behind the back of God. As far as the east is from the west, we are now clean because of the shed blood of Jesus on the cross. O Lord, our God, as we revel in that forgiveness, I pray that you will give us the grace to offer forgiveness to others who have wounded us. And I pray that you will give us the grace to ask forgiveness of those we have wounded. It's what we do right now, thanking you for forgiving us through that blood shed, remembering it. We worship you. We honor you. We thank you. And we say we want to be your obedient children all our days. And so together, in remembrance, we drink of this cup. The Bible says, as often as you eat the bread and you drink the cup, you proclaim the name of the Lord until he comes again. Even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Let's rise together and worship in this last song.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter will prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. Oh, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast. Those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He must let my soul be lost. His promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost. He will hold me fast. Oh, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so, he will hold me fast. For my life he bled and died. Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till my faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last. Oh, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so, he will.
What a good Savior He is. He is the God who exercises mercy and calls upon us to do the same. He's the God who forgives and says, go and forgive likewise. He is the God who bore the stripes of our sins on His body and shouted out, now you are healed spiritually in every way that offering is made to us. My prayer this day for us all is that we will be healers going out from this room into this community, and that every touch, every word will be a touch and a word that represents our forgiving God, His holiness and His truth. May you go this day in His peace. God bless you all.